Hi everyone, and welcome to my channel where we are talking about all things science and space. For this video, we are going to mix things up a bit and get a little more personal. I asked if any of you all had questions for me over on my Facebook page, and today I'm going to answer a few of them here. We'll talk about what got me into science when I was younger, how I felt when I learned that Emily's Wonder Lab was not getting a season 2, what's next for me as a book author, and what I like to do for fun. So grab your coziest sweatshirt and a cup of hot chocolate and get ready for the very first Space Gal, Space Pal chat. Alrighty friends, let's get into it. We're gonna start with a few questions from my Facebook subscribers. And remember, you can subscribe yourself by just heading over to my Facebook page and clicking the subscribe button. We'll start off with subscriber Andrea, who asked, what helped keep me interested in science as a kid? This is a similar question to a lot of other questions I got, which basically asked, you have 4 degrees in science and engineering. What initiated that spark in science for you? And you might be surprised to know that I actually didn't love science when I was a kid. I actually loved math. Math for me was much more clean and precise. Science felt a bit more messy and complicated. I never really had a science teacher who could teach me science in a way that I understood easily. But math, there was one exact answer and I could memorize all the rules to get to it, and math made me feel smart. Math was just perfect for someone like me who loved to memorize rules and the order that you needed to follow them in. So that's sort of how I got into engineering, but I really fell into this career for more practical reasons. My dad grew up in poverty in West Virginia, and he worked his way up to bring my family to middle class. And I had that legacy in the back of my mind when I went to decide which major I wanted to choose in college. And so the way that I chose to go into engineering was I Googled, as a high school senior, all of the majors that one could major in college, and I looked at their starting salaries. And it turns out that engineers often make the most money. I was someone who wanted to make my family proud and continue the legacy of working hard like my dad did. And so I chose to go into engineering to make money. I thought that my college career was going to be boring and hard and I was going to hate it, but I was going to end up with a good job in the end. But it turns out that I loved it. I became obsessed with learning about science and space. I found it to be fun. I found that I was good at it. I loved the discovery and the awe and the way that you could help people with technology. Like, it all became so fascinating. And that's a little bit of how I got into the career that I have today. Subscriber Erica asks, who is my favorite STEM role model and how do they influence my life? Well, my favorite STEM role models are the ones who can combine creativity with their passion and knowledge of science. People who can combine songwriting, storytelling, comedy, or stop motion animation with their knowledge and love of science. Because these types of really creative people are going to reach a new audience who hasn't seen themselves in science before. They're going to create content that is more captivating than a textbook. These people simply push me to be more creative in my own work. I'll link a few of the people that I think that you should follow who I find to be very creative in the caption. Next, Matt asks, crunchy or smooth peanut butter? Smooth peanut butter, but that's only because that's the kind that I give to my children and I eat their leftovers. So is it actually my preference or am I just adopting the interests of my kids, one of which is too young to probably even have crunchy peanut butter? The world may never know. Now, subscriber Morgan says, I have a behind the scenes Emily's Wonder Lab question. How many takes did the horse toothpaste experiment take? She noticed that there were a couple of clips that didn't seem consistent, where there was a mess in one of the girls' bows on one take and not in the other. And Morgan, you are quite perceptive, because yes, we absolutely had to do that experiment twice. The first time I did the experiment, I mixed the ingredients, the hydrogen peroxide and the potassium iodide, in the same proportions that I did in my practice and prep leading up to filming. But what I didn't account for was how hot the day was and how long the experiment was going to be sitting out in the sun. Because as you may know, when you're filming, everything takes a long time. We're setting up the kids and the lighting and the audio, and there's always these things that you need to tweak that make the setup a little bit longer than you expect. And so all of the ingredients were just sitting in the sun. And what happens to a chemical reaction when it gets hotter? All of the molecules are moving more quickly. So the reaction happens a lot more quickly. First take, when we did the horse toothpaste, it shot up out of those flasks much more quickly than I had anticipated, meaning it was much messier than I had anticipated. And they were like, let's try to do that again without getting the horse toothpaste in everybody's hair. So on the second take, I put a little bit less hydrogen peroxide in the flask, I believe, and made the potassium iodide a little bit less concentrated so that the reaction didn't shoot up as fast. So you were exactly right. We had to do that experiment twice because I forgot to account for the heat of the day. Next, Jesse asks, what was the hardest part about getting my degree? So in college, I dual majored. I did mechanical and aerospace engineering for undergrad, and in grad school, I got two masters, aeronautics and astronautics and technology and policy. And the hardest part of all of that, especially in undergrad, was time management. Engineering is one of those majors that's often known as a hard major. And what people really mean, I think, when they say that is that it's a time-consuming major. Because I am of the mindset that everything in the universe is understandable if only you have enough time to learn it. I lived and died by my schedule and my to-do list. I would schedule my day by the minute. If I had 15 extra minutes before class, I would use those minutes wisely. I prided myself in squeezing productivity into every minute of every day. That didn't mean that I didn't socialize in college, but I was very intentional about how and when I did socialize because I loved working early mornings, Saturdays and Sundays at my local Panera. So when I did go out, I never stayed out late. You could always find me in my Panera on Saturday morning studying orbital mechanics or Russian or whatever I was learning at the time. The work that I put in on weekends allowed me to stay on top of my schedule throughout the week. But of course, working that much did require some sacrifices. I actually did join a sorority in college, but I had to drop out because it was just too time consuming and too expensive. That was actually kind of difficult because the girls in the sorority weren't especially kind to me after I decided to drop out. But the life lesson that I learned there is that sometimes in life, you'll have to make decisions that others may not agree with. And the hard part is realizing that that is okay because not everybody has your best interests at heart. This next question is from Nicole. She says, when they told you you'd be filming a streaming series while very pregnant, did you dread it a little or were you excited to showcase being a woman scientist, literally creating life with her body at the same time? Okay, so I don't know if I've told the story publicly before, but when I pitched the show to Netflix, nobody knew I was pregnant. I was maybe 3.5 months pregnant at the time, and I wore this flowy shirt and loose jeans to hide my ever so slightly growing baby bump. And I hid it, not because I was ashamed to be pregnant and pitching a science show, but because I was terrified that that would affect their decision on whether or not they liked my show. I never really saw pregnant women on TV doing anything other than being pregnant. And I thought, you know, asking to be a female TV host of a science show was extreme enough, was groundbreaking enough. Asking to be a pregnant woman hosting a science show, I assumed that that was going to be too extreme, but it turns out it wasn't. A few weeks went by after the pitch, and of course I am growing every single day, and I'm going to weddings, and I'm doing public speeches, and I'm taking pictures with people that are going to end up online, so I had to announce it eventually. As you may know, I announced my pregnancy by launching my ultrasound to the edge of space with a high altitude balloon, perhaps a story for a different day. So the news was out there, and eventually I got the call from Netflix, and they said, do you want to film the show before or after the baby comes. This was my first child. I didn't know what it was going to be like to have a baby, and I assumed it was going to be hard. So I said, let's film it before the baby comes. So yes, I was a little bit nervous because while I didn't know what it was like to have a baby, I also didn't know what it was going to be like to film 12-hour days, 9 months pregnant. Like, I was literally 36 weeks pregnant. So my husband came with me. He stayed with me the entire time. We researched the nearest hospital, and my husband drew this like really weird baby creature on a piece of paper, and we sectioned it off into 6 days. And every day after my 12 hours of filming, we would come back to the hotel and we would shade in one of the sections. Every day, I would be so thankful that we made it another filming day without going in to early labor. And I would talk to my growing baby bump and I would tell her, like, come on, baby, let's just stay in there a little bit longer. We are almost done. Turns out she listened a little bit too well because she had to be induced a week after her due date. So long story short, now there is a wildly pregnant lady hosting a science show in 190 countries and 38 different languages on the largest streaming platform in the world. Next, Tori's 9-year-old asks, what kind of school do I need to do to learn how to design and build rockets? Well, Tori's 9-year-old, while you're little, I recommend learning all about model rockets and seeing if your school has a first robotics club or a Lego robotics club or a Girls Who Code club. When you're older and you're going to college, I recommend aerospace engineering. That is what I studied. I have a lot of friends who also studied aerospace engineering who are now working at companies like Blue Origin and SpaceX who are helping them design their rockets. Kat asks, what was your first big, oh my God, I can't believe I just did that moment as a professional? That moment for me was when I completed my first TEDx talk. I have now done 3 TEDx talks, but my first one, I Don't Do Math, was in front of thousands of people. I had never, never stood in front of that many people in my life. I think I was probably 24, 25 at the time. I was fairly young in my career, and I practiced my TEDx talk so much. I practiced it so many times that I memorized every single word. And when I got on that stage, you can see it in the video, when I got on that stage, I was frozen solid. I did not move a single muscle. When my body froze, my sort of subconscious took over and was able to rattle off the words that I had practiced so much. And I was just terrified. But because I got the entire speech out, when I walked off that stage after I was done, I was so proud of myself. I get chills just thinking about it. I was like, I just did that. I can't believe I just did that. And I didn't mess up. I didn't trip. I didn't mess up a single word. And it was only after I watched the video that I realized that I was frozen solid. I think that adrenaline rush that I felt after delivering a message that I had worked so hard on and I was so proud of in front of so many people and delivering it well, that is what fueled my desire to be a public speaker. And that is what kicked off my public speaking career. Ashley's 5-year-old asks, what is my favorite thing to do on my days off? Well, Ashley's 5-year-old, I live close to Disneyland, and so my favorite thing to do on my days off is take my kids to Disneyland. We have a season pass, so we go there probably too frequently. We go there a lot. We go there probably too much. In college, I actually worked in Disney World as part of the Disney College program because I wanted to be an Imagineer when I grew up, and I took Disney's Imagineering class. Yeah, I'm a pretty hardcore Disney fan. And so if you happen to find yourself at Disneyland, there is a good chance you will find me and my family there. And if you do, please come up and say hi because I love seeing you guys there. John asks, I'm curious, did your parents steer you in the direction of STEM or did you go your own way and were they supportive? I'm the first person in my family or extended family to pursue a degree in STEM. I didn't really know any scientists or engineers growing up. For me, this was a very new path that I was going on. But the thing that my parents did, they supported me and they loved me and they took an interest in what I was learning. So if you are a parent of a child who is interested in science, but you don't know anything about science yourself, and you're looking for ways to make sure they feel supported in their journey of loving science, I don't know that I have all the answers for you on how to do that, but I know personally, my parents, all they did was love me and support me and make me feel capable, and that was everything personally that I needed to succeed. So yes, there is always some toy or book or class that you can buy or purchase or sign your kid up for to help support their love of STEM. But I think the most important thing, the foundational thing that they need is your love and support to make them feel capable of pursuing hard things. And Ray asks, how I felt when I learned that Emily's Wonder Lab was not getting renewed for another season. Oh, yes. To be honest, I was mostly confused because the response from you all was just so overwhelmingly positive. I was receiving messages by the dozens on Instagram, on Facebook, everywhere, of families who were just obsessed with the show. And they didn't just like the show, they were grateful for the show because of what it was doing to their kids. It helped inspire a love of science in kids, and people loved seeing a woman hosting the show. And so I fully expected them to reach out and be like, okay, we're gonna need like 3 more seasons, stat. Which may have been a little naive of me, but I created a document of like 50 more episode ideas because I had all of these ideas. You know, I literally wrote a full book on all of the science experiment ideas that I had. When they weren't interested in another season, I was obviously incredibly disappointed, but more than anything, I was confused. I don't really know why it didn't get picked up, other than the fact that networks tend to assume that families prefer more animated content than live action. Live action means there are physical humans in the show, which was Emily's Wonderland. Is that the right assumption, that families with little kids only want animated shows? I don't know, but you all tried to tell them otherwise. This wasn't me, this was totally independent. Somebody created a change.org petition to get Emily's Wonder Lab renewed. And the last I checked, I think it had over 90,000 signatures. 90,000 signatures, 90,000 people signing a petition to renew a children's show. Like, I'd never seen anything like that before. It was such a popular petition that the company change.org reached out to me to tell me that they were giving it a unique URL, so you can still find it. It's change.org/Emily's Wonder Lab. Even though that petition wasn't necessarily successful yet, it still made me feel really good. It makes me feel like I want to keep pulling on that thread and create more science-related content for that age demographic, because that is a really key demographic to keep kids, especially girls, engaged with science and make them feel like they can see themselves in science. Even still today, I'm constantly pitching similar shows, not like Emily's Wonder Lab, but in the same vein of science and kids with myself as the host. So there is hope for the future that a similar show for your kids will be created. And to get ahead of the follow-up questions, no, unfortunately, we can't take Emily's Wonder Lab anywhere else because Netflix owns the IP and it still does well for them. And so they want to keep it on the streaming platform. And to be honest, I'm so proud of the show. I'm so proud that it's a Netflix show. And I love everything about Emily's Wonder Lab, and I just hope to create more content that's very similar and creates a similar passion for science in the future. And finally, Brittany asks, what's next for me as an author? Her kid wants to know if there will be more Ada Lace books in her future. Well, Brittany's kid, do I have a surprise for you, because I just got some of the first early proofs of my very next Ada Lace book, Ada Lace Gets Famous. And I am oh so excited for you to read this one. This is the first Ada Lace book we've written in, gosh, how many years? Like 4 years? It's a good one. I'm very excited for this one to come out. You can pre-order Ada Lace Gets Famous today. This is the 6th book in the series. I also have my next Stay Curious and Keep Exploring book coming out next year. I just finished writing all of the science experiments for that. Right now, we're kind of working on the cover because we want it to have the same look and feel of this one, but also look different enough so that you know that it's a different book. And that's proved to be a bit of a challenge. So I'm excited to show you that one once we finally decide on what the cover paper will look like, but I'm always working on something new for the next big project because these books, they take so long to come out. You write them, they need to be illustrated and then edited, and it's like 2 years from conception where these actually come into the world. So I'm always working on the next big project that will hopefully come out in like a year or two from now. All right, friends, that is all the time we have for this AMA video, but I plan to do more videos like this. So if you have a question that you would like me to answer in the next video like this, please ask it in the comments below or over on my Facebook subscriber page. Thanks for joining this one. Stay tuned for many more videos on science and space. And as always, stay curious and keep exploring. We'll see you next time.